British soldier. All around the globe you'll find him, from Gibraltar to Hong Kong. Everywhere he stands against the threatening years, staunch symbol of our common will to order.
Britansko carstvo, najveće carstvo u povijesti svijeta. Tijekom više od 300 godina Britanija je vladala, njezina je vojska osvajala, a njezini su bankari veličali moć njezine valute. No jednoga se dana sve počelo urušavati. Države su jedna po jedna proglašavale svoju neovisnost o Britaniji i nikakva sila nije mogla zaustaviti taj trend. Nemoćno promatrajući kako gubi bogatstvo, povlastice i carstvo, britanska elita počela tražiti novu ulogu u svijetu koji se mijenjao i pronašla ju je u financijskom sektoru. Ovaj film pokazuje kako se Britanija preobrazila iz kolonijalne u modernu financijsku silu i kako je ta preobrazba oblikovala svijet u kojem živimo. U doba britanskog carstva londonski City bio je najveći globalni financijski centar.
The City of London was the kind of beating financial heart of the British Empire. The historians Kane and Hopkins called it the governor of the imperial engine. All these countries in the empire used to use the sterling currency, and the City of London was kind of the financier of this, not just inside the sterling zone but outside the sterling zone as well.
Kako je opadala moć britanskog carstva, opadala i moć Citya.
One British army truck is bombed, killing two soldiers and wounding 12. As rioting becomes daily more widespread on Cyprus, young people of high school age take an increasing part in the violence. Here a group of girls are being dispersed after a rock-throwing battle with British military police.
S propadanjem carstva bili su ugroženi britanski komercijalni interesi diljem svijeta. Egipat je 1956. nacionalizirao Suezki kanal.
A new Middle East crisis arises as President Nasser of Egypt tells a wildly cheering crowd in Alexandria that Egypt has seized the internationally owned Suez Canal. France and Britain issue a 12-hour ultimatum. Within hours of its expiration, Britain's warplanes are winging their way to Egypt and its bombers attack five key cities including Cairo.
SAD se protivio toj invaziji te izvršio pritisak na Britaniju i Francusku da povuku svoje vojnike.
There will be no United States involvement in these present hostilities. It is our hope and intent this matter will be brought before the United Nations General Assembly. There, the opinion of the world can be brought to bear in our quest for a just end to this tormenting problem.
Britanija je bila ponižena. Suezka kriza označila je završetak njezine uloge jedne od najvećih svjetskih sila.
Following the crisis, there was a run on the sterling, on the UK pound. Some people suspect that the American government was encouraging this run on the UK pound.
Kako su ulagači povlačili novac iz Britanije? Vrijednost je funte padala. Kako bi zaštitila vrijednost funte, Britanija je bankama ograničila prekomorska ulaganja.
They were not able to invest abroad, and obviously they were unhappy, and we don't know exactly the context, but it's very clear that the banks or their representative made a representation to the Bank of England, which in itself was dominated by representative from the banking industry. It seems that they have reached an agreement which was never written, that if the banks intermediated between two non-residents in a foreign currency, in that case dollar, that this particular intermediation, this particular deal, will not be considered by the Bank of England under its own jurisdiction.
Banke su počele kreirati tržište za dolare u Londonu zvano londonsko eurodolarsko tržište, kako bi razlikovale te eurotržišne aktivnosti od svojih tuzemnih bankarskih aktivnosti. Banke su imale dva niza računa. Engleska banka, središnja banka Ujedinjenog kraljevstva, izjavila je da račune londonskog eurotržišta nisu u Londonu, nego negdje drugdje, i da zato ona nije odgovorna za njihovo reguliranje.
It's about providing a legal space in which you pretend activity is taking place. And the importance of that is that you pretend it's not taking place in the economy where it really is taking place. So you're taking activity from the place where it's regulated and taxed and pretending that it's happening elsewhere. Now, where doesn't really matter, it's just elsewhere.
Kad su američke banke shvatile da im London nudi mogućnost da izbjegnu američke propise, preselile su svoje međunarodne operacije u City. City, londonska financijska četvrt, neobično je mjesto. Zovu ga gradom unutar grada, državom unutar države. Njime upravlja organizacija zvana Korporacija Londonskoga Citya, privatna tvrtka koja obavlja sve funkcije lokalne samouprave, te posjeduje privatnu policiju i privatne sudove.
Those of you who aren't from the UK, some of you even who are, might not be aware just how weird a thing the little city of London is within the big London. The city of London is a separate entity to the wider London, and it has its own head, the Lord Mayor, who's distinct from the Mayor, who runs the rest of London.
Svakog studenoga City organizira paradu Lorda Gradonačelnika, najstariju svjetovnu procesiju na svijetu.
The City of London has long had this curious legal status because back in 1066, when William the Conqueror came over, the city was one of the only portions of England that he failed to conquer, and he struck a deal with the city in 1067 that allowed them to continue functioning.
City je i danas izuzet iz mnogobrojnih zakona koje vrijede u ostatku Britanije. Njegov politički sustav potiče iz srednjega vijeka. Biračkim tijelom Citya ne dominiraju njegovi stanovnici, nego privatne tvrtke sa sjedištem u Cityju, a lorda gradonačelnika biraju predsjednici srednjovjekovnih cehova.
They have a representative in the House of Commons called the Remembrancer. Apart from the clerks of the court of the House of Commons, he's the only unelected person there.
All other lobbyists have to stop, you know, in the lobby. They're not allowed past the lobby.
City ima stalnog predstavnika u parlamentu, čija je uloga izvješćivati korporaciju londonskog Citya o novostima i lobirati u parlamentu za interese Citya.
The Corporation of London, clearly, it's a unique and interesting phenomenon that should have attracted many political scientists, political economists and economists. But I don't know of anyone who has studied systematically the Corporation of London and its impact on policy or economic policy. So we can only surmise. Some people assume or surmise that the Corporation of London is extremely powerful and is able in one way or another to shape British policy, particularly in financial matters.
Clement Attlee, the Prime Minister after the Second World War, had something to say about the City of London Corporation.
He did, so, yeah. So over and over again, we have seen that there is in this country another power than that which has its seat at Westminster. The City of London, a convenient term for a collection of financial interests, is able to assert itself against the government of the country. Those who control money can pursue a policy at home and abroad, contrary to that which has been decided by the people.
Počevši od 60. godina 20. stoljeća, institucije City-a počele su otvarati offshore podružnice u bivšim kolonijama Britanskoga carstva. Željele su stvoriti offshore centre u kojima će na snazi biti bankarska tajna kako bi privukli kapital iz cijelog svijeta.
Swiss banking secrecy is the most famous and most well known. You know, you put your money in a Swiss bank and they promise not to tell anybody, and that's one kind of secrecy. But another kind of secrecy, which is very British, is the trust. And the trust is a very slippery, complicated and devious mechanism. Trusts emerged, the legend has it, from the time of the Crusades, when the knights would go off and fight in foreign lands and they would leave their assets in the care of trusted stewards. What trusts do ultimately is they play with the concept of ownership. Ownership is not such a simple thing. So the settlor, the knight in this case, would hand over the assets to someone who these days would be called a trustee. It's often a lawyer. Legally, you are separated from those assets. They're not yours anymore. There's a barrier. You can't be taxed on them. You can't be... Nobody's going to find anything about your connection to these assets.
U britanskim offshore jurisdikcijama nisu vam potrebne nikakve kvalifikacije da biste bili povjerenik. Svatko može osnovati trust i raditi kao povjerenik. Ne postoji nikakav registar trustova. Ne postoje tijela koja potvrđuju da je trust osnovan.
The only persons who know about the creation of this agreement are the trustee and the settlor. There's no obligation to register it. There is no financial reporting obligation of trusts. They're not required to put annual statements onto account anywhere. So actually trusts are, to all intents and purposes, invisible arrangements.
John Christensen, 10. godine, bio ekonomski savjetnik u offshore jurisdikciji na otoku Jerseyu.
We're not talking about a few million, we're talking now about trillions. Trillions of dollars of capital, which apparently belong to nobody. For tax purposes and for other purposes, they belong to nobody. Everything, works of arts, gold bullion, horse race horses, cars, real estate, not just financial assets, but a whole load of non-financial assets, belong to these trusts. Sitting there, belonging to nobody. Now think that one through, because we are talking about maybe as much as $50 trillion of assets sitting offshore behind these instruments.
Well, the Cayman Islands are among several British overseas territories who have signed a new information exchange agreement with Britain and the rest of Europe to tackle tax evasion. The countries are now required to automatically provide details of the ownership of bank accounts and how they're used. Cayman became the first signatory last week.
It's important that the Cayman Islands should be recognised as the first overseas territory to sign such an agreement with the United Kingdom. And I think this importantly reflects the constructive approach that the Cayman Islands has taken in delivering our shared objective of rooting out tax evasion.
The trust lies at the core of the British secrecy model. They don't use banking secrecy. The Swiss use banking secrecy. The British, of course, are only too willing to kill off banking secrecy because they will then capture a larger market share. That's why the Brits are doing this.
Trustovi su temeljni elementi anglosaksonske diskrecije na kojima se grade kompleksne offshore strukture. Svaka offshore jurisdikcija nudi specifičan niz usluga, od trustova i fiktivnih tvrtki do tajnih bankovnih računa i nominalnih direktora. Povezivanje tih usluga u kompleksne strukture, koje obuhvaćaju nekoliko jurisdikcija, omogućuje nastanak tajnovitih struktura u koje je gotovo nemoguće prodrijeti.
We know everything today because we have had the Panama Papers, we have seen it, and we are not able to act upon it. And we are not able to act upon it because this system is really protecting the few people that are having benefit from it. And these are in percentage very few people, but they are powerful. And I see in the Panama committee that I'm sitting in, the only thing that could change this is to have a public accessible register of the beneficial ownership of trusts and of all kind of companies. It is easy.
Panamski dokumenti povjerljivi su dokumenti koji su procurili iz odvjetničke tvrtke Mossack Fonseca. To je četvrta po veličini offshore odvjetnička tvrtka. Preostalih 9 od 10 najvećih offshore odvjetničkih tvrtki registrirano je u britanskim prekomorskim jurisdikcijama. Kad se zemlje žale Britaniji zbog aktivnosti u njezinim poreznim oazama, Britanija tvrdi da su ta mjesta samostalna i da je ona nemoćna.
I've heard time and time again from officials in Berlin and in Paris and in Washington and in other countries that they've been told by the British government that, yes, they're well aware of what's going on in Jersey and they think it's very unfortunate, but they don't have the powers to intervene. Well, that's a straightforward lie. They do have the powers to intervene. They just choose not to.
Britain plays this kind of game of pretending when it suits them to pretend that these places are independent. At the end of the day, Britain appoints the governor, appoints lots of senior people in these places. They're responsible for foreign relations and defence, and also they can veto their legislation as well. So Britain has a massive degree of control. Basically, it is controlling these places, allowing them a little bit of political space.
Dok je radio kao ekonomski savjetnik na Jerseyu, John Christensen redovito je putovao u London na razgovore s različitim britanskim vladinim predstavnicima.
As economic advisor, I had a lot of contact with different departments. Traditionally, UK governments have tried not to interfere in the domestic affairs of places like Jersey. So it happens in a more subtle sort of way. You kind of go and talk to someone either at the Home Office or the Treasury, and they'd say, well, I'm not actually particularly keen on this piece of legislation. It might be a good idea if you didn't go down that route. And over a cup of tea, that's quite a strong signal. That's a signal, go back to the island and say, they don't want you to do this.
Britanska vlada ne želi se otvoreno upletati, nego komunicira svoje želje u neslužbenim razgovorima. Nema pisanog traga ni službenih izjava. Razgovori se vode iza zatvorenih vrata.
The relationship that these places have with London is very much about the British establishment and people understanding each other. I mean, anybody who is British or knows British people knows that communication between us is often very subtle, and you have to kind of know the codes when people say stuff. I mean, a lot of irony involved and a lot of kind of codified language. The British establishment that people kind of understand how it works, and I think that is very much the case with the British relationship with the tax havens. I think there's a lot of understanding of what we can and can't do without anyone having to actually spell it out.
Skrivajući svoju moć, Britanija može tvrditi da su te jurisdikcije politički autonomne.
Independence for Cayman is not on government's agenda. That's the message being sent to the UN Special Committee on Decolonization. Attorney Steve McPhail will be representing government at the UN meeting. The committee was set up to help colonies around the world on the road to independence. But Mr. McPhail says he'll be making it clear that Cayman is not ready for that transition.
And that message is that the Premier, his cabinet, his party has no mandate from the people of the Cayman Islands to seek independence. That is the message that I will be carrying.
Danas je Ujedinjeno Kraljevstvo najveći pružatelj međunarodnih financijskih usluga na svijetu.
The UK has an almost unique role in global finance. If you look at data, the kind of data that we've constructed in the Financial Secrecy Index, you can see the relative shares of each country in the global provision of financial services exports, that's financial services to non-residents. Now, there are two big centers and everything else is quite small in comparison.
Dva su velika središta, SAD s oko 19% globalnog tržišta i Ujedinjeno Kraljevstvo i njegove offshore jurisdikcije koje drže 25% globalnog tržišta.
And if you add to that other jurisdictions
ex-colonies, but recently independent, fairly recently, by which I mean Hong Kong, Singapore, maybe even Dubai and Bahrain, and Cyprus, then you reach a figure of nearly 40%. And I think that figure represents better the position of London in the global financial market.
The soldiers left, the administrators left all the colonies, but they still kept a significant degree of control over the financial flows from these former former parts of empire and the rest of the world. So you could describe it as a second empire, Britain's second empire, sort of hidden financial empire spanning large parts of the globe.
U doba Britanskog carstva, londonski je City bio najveće globalno financijsko središte. Nisu samo britanske kolonije, nego su i samostalne države obavljale bankarske poslove u Londonu, služeći se valutom carstva u trgovini i ulaganjima. Kako je opadala moć carstva, opadala je i moć Citya. Osnutak londonskog eurotržišta omogućuje bankama u Cityju da nastave iskorištavati mreže i ekspertizu iz vremena carstva. A uspostava offshore jurisdikcija osigurala je bankama pristup velikim količinama jeftinog novca. Međunarodne banke iz cijelog svijeta otvorile su podružnice u Londonu i u britanskim offshore jurisdikcijama kako bi iskoristile taj novi sustav.
This system has taken the place of the occupation, up till 62. For France, I don't know for England, but about the same time, England were physically present in India, for instance, or in other colonies. And when you look at the money flows through the tax havens, they are increasing when we withdraw from the colonies. We are still plundering developing countries as former colonial powers.
Bogati pojedinci, organizirani kriminal i korporacije preselili su svoje bogatstvo u porezne oaze u zamjenu za diskreciju i neplaćanje poreza. A kako su zemlje diljem svijeta počele deregulirati i otvarati svoja gospodarstva, to je postalo još lakše. Danas je čak polovina globalnog offshore bogatstva možda skrivena u britanskim offshore jurisdikcijama. Jedan je od gubitnika u toj priči Afrika, čiji bijeg kapitala uglavnom završava u modernoj britanskoj paukovoj mreži.
I think it's no coincidence that Britain's offshore empire emerged more or less at the same time as the collapse of the formal empire.
We tend to think of Africa as being a huge net debtor to the rest of the world. But that was the extent of their debts at the end of 2008, 177 billion.
Dug subsaharskih afričkih zemalja iznosio je 2008. 177 milijarda dolara, no prema procjenama između 1970. i 2008. elite tih zemalja prebacile su u porezne oaze čak 944 milijarde dolara, oko 5 puta više od njihova vanjskog duga.
944 billion dollars. Do the maths. Far from being a net debtor, Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, is a net creditor to the rest of the world.
Dok je kapital odlazio u porezne oaze, afričke su zemlje pozajmljivale novac od međunarodnih banaka uz visoku kamatu. S vremenom su ti dugovi postali toliko veliki da možda nikad neće biti otplaćeni. Porezne su oaze lišile zemlje u razvoju njihova bogatstva i prihoda od poreza.
For a long time, a lot of developing countries, including recently Ecuador, have been trying to set up a UN tax body which is of a higher value than what is currently there, which is the UN Tax Committee. And every time this has happened, it has gotten blocked. During the financing for development process in Addis Ababa last year, I think it was the UK and the US that blocked attempts again to set up this World Tax Organization. So why would they not want to have democratic decision-making
in global decisions on how tax gets collected across borders. I don't understand this. As long as we have cross-border activity that involves both criminal and legal activity, as long as we're unable to separate the two, this is going to continue to be a problem.
Zemlje Zapada blokiraju pokušaj uvođenja veće transparentnosti međunarodnih financijskih tokova te implementaciju globalnih standarda za ubiranje poreza preko granica, dok elite u zemljama u razvoju skrivaju svoje bogatstvo u porezne oaze.
The oil from Gabon has not benefited people in Gabon. And this is true for the copper in Zambia, for the gold in Mozambique or in Mali. They have benefited the company that to extract it and their shareholders. It has benefited the corrupt elite in the country.
In developing countries, the offshore system of tax havens has facilitated the looting of these countries by their elites. It has enabled them to steal the money and keep it safe somewhere else.
Illicit financial flows, because the anonymity that drives them creates incentives for people in positions of power to be corrupt. This is why there's a group of countries where development progress is so difficult. It's that the incentives of individuals and the ability to pursue them through all the mechanisms that underpin illicit flows outweigh the type of mechanisms that lead you to a powerful, representative, effective state that can start to deliver development.
Zemlje u razvoju diljem svijeta gube više od bilijun dolara svake godine zbog bijega, kapitala i porezne utaje. Većina tog bogatstva odlazi u velike zemlje zapada, poput SAD-a i Britanije, te omogućuje da njihove valute ostanu jake, dok valute zemalja u razvoju ostaju slabe. Ali nezakonito prebacivanje novca u zemlje zapada imalo je još jednu neočekivanu nuspojavu. Gospodarstva SAD-a i Britanije počela su se financijalizirati. Početci te financijalizacije ili deindustrializacije sežu u 60. godine 20. stoljeća.
Anti-war demonstrators protest U.S. involvement in the Vietnam War in mass marches, rallies, and demonstrations. President Johnson, meanwhile, let it be known that the FBI is closely watching all anti-war activity.
Američki ekonomist Michael Hudson u 60-ima je u banci Chase Manhattan na Wall Streetu bio zadužen za platnu bilancu.
During the 1960s, the United States' balance of payments deficit was entirely a result of foreign military expenditures.
Dolari su otjecali iz SAD-a kao posljedica troškova Vijetnamskog rata. SAD je pokušao spriječiti da dolari koji odlaze u Vijetnam završe u stranim bankama.
The government asked Chase to set up a branch in Saigon during the Vietnam War. And as you can imagine, it didn't have windows. It was sort of a fortress. It lost money. But the government went to Chase because it said, if you don't get this money that's being thrown off by the military in Vietnam, then it's going to go into French banks. It'll get to General de Gaulle, and you know what he's going to do every month. He's going to cash it in for gold. That's what the United States was trying to stop.
Amerika nije uspjela zaustaviti odljev novca, pa je počela kovati drukčiji plan. Godine 1967. bivši zaposlenik State Departmenta dao je Michaelu Hudsonu jedan dopis.
In 1967, I was given by a former State Department employee in the elevator at Chase Manhattan a memo from the State Department urging that Chase Manhattan would take the lead in helping the United States become the Switzerland of the world, meaning the flight capital. The State Department, through Chase, asked me to estimate how much money do you think is available if America were to become the new Switzerland, and how do we do it? The plan was to organize offshore banking centers in the Caribbean and elsewhere, and the hot money wouldn't come directly into Chase because that wouldn't be nice and very legal. What happened was that the Latin American criminals, other criminals, drug dealers, all sorts of organized crime, would put their money in the offshore Caribbean banks, and these offshore banks would then deposit the inflow in the head office.
Prebacujući dolare iz poreznih oaza natrag u SAD, Amerika je uspjela zaustaviti odljev novca i održati vrijednost svoje valute. Uz prešutnu potporu SAD-a, britanska su porezna utočišta brzo rasla i ubrzo je offshore sustav prerastao u dominantno međunarodno financijsko tržište. Malo je ljudi znalo kako to tržište funkcionira. Godine 1986. ekonomist John Christensen otišao je to istražiti. Prijavio se za posao u podružnici jedne od velikih računovodstvenih tvrtki na Jerseyu.
Well, Deloitte and Touche, I was working in what's called company and trust administration, straightforward offshore stuff. I went offshore specifically to work in that area because that's where you're dealing with the offshore companies, the shell companies, the offshore trusts, and you're administering them. That way I could see from working inside a big global accounting firm exactly what the clients were doing.
I had complete access to all the client files. And over the course of my period of working with Deloitte Touche, I investigated over 100 of their clients offshore, and this is what I found. There were some insider traders, some market rigging, some avoiding disclosure of conflicts of interest, illicit arms trading, illicit political campaign donations, contract kickbacks, bribery, fraudulent invoicing, trade mispricing, and at the bottom, tax evasion. Okay? This is what the clients were doing.
Danas su gotovo polovina svjetskih poreznih oaza britanski teritorij. U javnosti te jurisdikcije tvrde da su transparentne i da se njihovi sektori financijskih usluga bave zakonitim financijskim aktivnostima.
Our economy is not based on secrecy. It's based on transparency. It's based on a sound regulatory environment. It's based on good governance and good government with a British government legal system. That's what our financial institutions are based on.
Well, tonight we have a response from the head of Cayman Finance after a group of U.S.-based anti-tax evasion activists announced plans to travel to Cayman to draw attention to what they feel is corporate tax evasion. Finance chairman Mr. Richard Cole says he's encouraging the group to visit and says our financial sector has nothing to hide.
I would say if anybody wants to come to Cayman to find out what's coming, you know, what we do here, come on down. We have no secrets here.
When I went to the Cayman Islands back in 2008, I think it was, I called the government spokesman and he said, okay, we have had an order from on high that nobody is allowed to speak to you. You are off limits.
Godine 2011. novinar Nicholas Shackson objavio je fascinantnu knjigu o offshore sustavu Otoci s blagom.
The author of a series of international media reports says he would welcome a debate with Cayman Finance Chair Tony Travers. Mr. Travers recently called Nicholas Shackson an imbecile with the understanding of an 11-year-old.
There are always going to be the politics of envy. Now, the politics of envy are exacerbated by imbeciles who don't actually understand what's going on in the Cayman Islands. I don't know what he's talking about. And furthermore, he doesn't know what he's talking about.
Kajmanski otoci peti su po veličini financijski centar u svijetu. Ondje je registrirano 80.000 tvrtki, 3/4 svjetskih hedge fondova, $1.9 billion depozita. A ondje živi 60.000 ljudi, što je ekvivalent broja beskućnika u New Yorku. Neobični likovi nastanjuju offshore svijet. Britanci koji su pohađali privatne škole, članovi svjetskih obavještajnih služba, globalni kriminalci, svakojaki lordovi i dame te mnoštvo bankara. Budući da je u igri velik novac, tolikih imućnih i moćnih pojedinaca, Nije čudo što su britanske porezne oaze osmislile vlastite neobične metode kojima spriječavaju curenje informacija.
For many people who work offshore and who don't like what they're doing, it's very hard indeed to dissent because they will be attacked personally with a degree of viciousness which is quite extraordinary. Most of the time the instruments of suppression are relatively sophisticated. You won't get promotion by doing this, or your family won't like it.
It's not generally, let's slam them in prison. That's far too crude. We are talking about very substantially, you know, the establishment, the British establishment in these cases. The mechanisms are very, very subtle. Sort of ostracism is one way of doing it. These peculiar mechanisms for, you know, if someone tries to blow the whistle, you find all sorts of methods that aren't the most, you know, just fire them. You give them far too much work to do. You steer them in a different direction.
Jedna osoba dobro zna kako funkcionira ušutkavanje u poreznim oazama. Bivši senator i ministar zdravstva Jerseya Stuart Seaver. On je 2009. objavio povjerljivo izvješće o medicinskoj sestri koja je osumnjičena da je ubijala pacijenta u bolnici na Jerseyu.
It all came to a head during a state's debate on Tuesday, the 10th of March. Senator Stuart Seaver brought the sitting to a standstill, claiming Senator Jimmy Pershard had sworn at him and told him to go and top himself. Senator Pershard denied the claim, saying, "I absolutely refute that." But less than a week later, he was forced to admit he'd lied. Senator Pershard has now admitted that on another occasion, he did tell Senator Stuart Seaver to go and do everyone a favour and slit his wrists.
I was arrested at my house one morning by six plainclothes police officers. There were another two specialist data search police officers on hand, and also another two police officers in full body armor with one of those battering rams they kind of use in drugs raids. So 10 police officers descended on me without a search warrant. The property was turned over from top to bottom. All of the computers were seized and searched. All kinds of private constituency data was stolen by the police.
Nedugo nakon što smo počeli snimati ovaj intervju, policajac je izašao iz postaje. U prolazu se nacerio prema kameri. Išao je testirati sirene na svojem motociklu, što je radio u intervalima tijekom ostatka našeg razgovora.
When it came to prosecuting me,
Stuart Seaver optužen je za kršenje zakona o zaštiti podataka.
Now, when the authorities were prosecuting me, I claimed that this was a legitimate public interest disclosure defense. And I, with an expert witness, was able to produce a set of reports that effectively destroyed the prosecution case.
Sud je tada ocijenio da argumentacija obrane, da je Seaver objavio tajno izvješće u interesu javnosti, više neće biti prihvatljiva. Ipak su mu nastavili suditi iako su odbacili argumentaciju obrane. U posljednjih 7 godina Stuart Seaver morao je opetovano ići na sud i 3 put je uhićen. Ne zna kada će i hoće li uopće njegov progon završiti, niti zna kada bi se ponovno mogao naći iza rešetaka.
To look at Jersey from the outside, it looks like it's got a prosecution system, it looks like it's got a court and a legislature, but none of it's real. It's a Potemkin village. None of these systems in Jersey meet the tests of being objective or actually functioning properly.
The experience that Stuart Seaver had is, you know, he's perhaps at the blunter end of the scale. You know, he was simply suppressed and taken to court on trumped up charges.
Let's carry on pretend to do the interview. They might get bored. This is the kind of how oppression happens in Jersey, see? All kinds of little things get done to harass people, you know. Even they don't often go to the kinds of extremes that they did against me in terms of actually arresting me and putting me in prison, but the authorities use all kinds of other lesser little methods to interfere with people, kind of sabotage things, you know, obstruct people, make life difficult for people. You know, if you annoy the establishment in Jersey, you won't get a job here. You know, you know, your children won't get decent jobs. You know, that's kind of how it works, you know.
I went to Jersey in March 29 with Nick Shackson. About 24 hours after we arrived in Jersey, we were there for several days. Nick said, did you know, have you noticed that we're being followed? Ever since we arrived at the airport, we've been followed. He said, don't look now, but we're being followed now. Turns out he was quite correct. We were being followed. And I found that very disturbing indeed.
Na Jerseyu postoji izreka, ako ti se ne sviđa ovdje, možeš slobodno ujutro otići. Promotivni materijal tvrtke Jersey Finers tvrdi da je Jersey produžetak londonskog Cityja.
It's where the city of London chooses to do many of the activities which they couldn't do in London itself.
We're here just to talk about this one company called Appleby. I'll just read what they say on their website. Members of the firm, Appleby, have gone on not only to political office, but also in a number of centres, Bermuda, Jersey, the Isle of Man and the Cayman Islands, to senior judicial office. So essentially, they're boasting of the fact that their staff and their partners have a real interchange between the people that are in power in these offshore financial centres.
Isti oni odvjetnici i računovođe koji osnivaju offshore tvrtke i upravljaju njima također su na visokim političkim položajima. U britanskom offshore svijetu većina su političara poslovni ljudi, lobiraju za tvrtke i zastupaju njihove interese. Sastavljaju, dotjeruju i donose zakone. Političari sjede u upravnim odborima tvrtki koje bi trebali regulirati.
There is no place for dirty money in Britain. Indeed, there should be no place for dirty money anywhere. The challenge I'm laying down for every country today is to root out the rot of corruption, to ensure transparency over what your own companies are doing. Require transparency for foreign companies in your country too, and work with us to spread this approach to transparency around the world.
Britanski političari u javnosti tvrde da se bore protiv poreznih oaza i korupcije, ali u stvarnosti čine suprotno.
When I talk to politicians in Brussels, they say that they've had more lobbyists from London, and including politicians, come to them to protect the City of London's interests than they've had from every other European member state combined. Which gives you some idea of the extent to which British politicians see themselves as essentially lobbyists for the City of London.
We begin with our big story. Cayman's efforts to ensure transparency in its financial services sector is being recognized by the international community. Earlier this week, the UK's Prime Minister, David Cameron, told Parliament that the tax haven label placed on its crown dependencies and overseas territories is unfair.
Mnogi britanski političari imaju osobne i poslovne veze sa Cityjem i britanskim poreznim oazama.
If you come from the same kind of background, you know the right people, then all the kind of legal niceties will often fall away. You can get away with doing all sorts of things that they wouldn't just let any old person, you know, if you came knocking on the door saying, can you set up an offshore company to do this, they'd tell you to get lost. But if you're part of the networks, you can do these kinds of things. So that's a very important part of the whole system. Upper class British public school kind of establishment that has been there since, you know, for centuries.
Britanski establishment, ta mreža pripadnika povlaštenih elita, uredila si je unosan kutak u offshore svijetu nakon propasti carstva. Preobrazili su se iz upravitelja carstva u financijske posrednike za globalne elite i multinacionalne korporacije. Kako je sve više novca odlazilo u porezne oaze, društva diljem svijeta počela su osjećati njihove posljedice.
The reality is not what you believe, that your prime minister has the power to decide on the future of your country. The power is hidden here.
We have country after country around the world where the lack of financial transparency about taxation, about ownership, about corruption has undermined the extent to which governments deliver representative policymaking for their citizens. You know, we have extreme cases like the hiding of tax evasion by people in finance ministries in Greece, in France. But we also have this system that in general is geared towards anonymous company ownership, the anonymous ownership of properties across London, of half of the land in Scotland. You know, do we really think there's any circumstances in which governments work better, in which markets work better, in which the distribution of income and assets is better, when we allow so much to be hidden? Who wants to not know who you're doing business with? Who wants their government to have people working for it, or to be led by people whose assets are hidden, whose financial transactions are conducted anonymously offshore? You know, this is a bad direction for the world.
We need the citizens to understand what is happening, that they are the ones who is carrying the burden, and that some individuals having the power are exonerating themselves. Ordinary people are paying taxes, rich people are not. So this is inequality, and it is leading up to populism, because it shows so clearly that the people today leading the world are not able to take care of the interest of ordinary people.
Back in the 60s and 70s, you know, tax evasion or pushing back against taxation, it was kind of seen as anti-establishment. So, you know, the Rolling Stones and Phil Collins, all these people kind of going offshore, going away. It was seen as a sort of rebellious thing to do. And if you fast forward to the present day, now that is the establishment. The offshore system is the establishment.
Danas elite i multinacionalne korporacije obavljaju svoje poslove u poreznim oazama. Porezna utaja sastavni je dio poslovanja.
This kind of sophisticated cheating requires a huge infrastructure. We like to talk about the pinstripe infrastructure of highly educated people who think it is their right to help others to cheat societies.
We have a new mafia in town. It does not actually shoot people, does not put bullets in their kneecaps, but its trade is just as deadly. It deprives people of opportunities to have healthcare, education, security, justice, and essentially a fulfilling life.
Računovođe su temelj offshore sustava. Oni upravljaju strukturama koje omogućuju privatnim osobama i korporacijama da presele novac u poreznu oazu i ne plate porez.
There are about 2.5 million professionally qualified accountants on this planet. About 330,000 are in the UK.
Well-known people, well-dressed, well-fed, highly paid, are sitting in city centre offices, and they are paid to dream up tax avoidance schemes for individuals and for corporations.
We can all elect a government which says, vote for us, we will give you better healthcare, better education, better security. And next day accountant says, sorry about that, folks, you elected this government, but we actually got a tax avoidance scheme, and the Amazons and the Googles and Microsofts won't be paying any taxes in your jurisdiction. Too bad you voted for it, but actually you're going to get something else.
So it's a crazy world. That part of the business model at big accountancy firms is how to deny public the services by erosion of tax revenues. And these firms are then rewarded with government-funded contracts, and the same firms are then advising local governments and the central governments, and the same firms then report on the company accounts and tell us all is well.
When I argue this with a Pricewaterhouse partner in a face-to-face debate, he said, Professor Sikka, you never give us credit for anything. We generate millions of dollars of revenues, and we have lots and lots of satisfied clients. What is your problem? And my response was very simple. That's the language of drug pushers and pimps.
U Britaniji se uzdigao novi tip državnog službenika. Takav je bio Dave Hartnett, koji je dospio na čelo britanske porezne uprave. Dave Hartnett smislio je novi način prikupljanja poreza. Dogovori će se sklapati pojedinačno, iza zatvorenih vrata. S najvećim klijentima Hartnett je često osobno pregovarao. British Telecom bio je među prvim tvrtkama koje su ušle u taj program i dobio je više od milijardu funta povrata. Glavni direktor Ben Verwaayen napisao je: "Dobit po dionici porasla je za 14%, a lijepo je znati i da imamo milijardu funti od porezne uprave." Dave Hartnett tvrdio je da je takav pristup učinkovitiji.
Litigation in the courts is really phenomenally expensive in this day and age all over the world. And I think it's to be avoided where possible. And the art is to persuade people to pay by strength of argument and the like.
Kad su izbili prosvjedi 2011. parlamentarni odbor za javne financije ispitao je Davea Hartnetta. On je tvrdio da ne smije otkriti nikakve informacije zbog povjerljivosti podataka poreznih obveznika.
What in statute prevents you from disclosing information to Parliament?
All my advice, Mr. Barclay, so far has been that I am prevented, and my colleagues are prevented, by the Act and by the decision of the Commissioners.
Dave Hartnett zaboravio je spomenuti da mu je pravna služba rekla da je otkrivanje informacija prepušteno diskrecijskoj ocjeni šefa porezne uprave. Šef porezne uprave bio je sam Dave Hartnett.
Just like the mafia has penetrated the state, accountancy firms have also penetrated the state. At the head of anti-avoidance in the UK tax authority is from one of these firms. The newly appointed chairman of Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs, which is a tax authority, is a partner from KPMG. Their partners have penetrated the state. They are running the treasury.
Britanska industrija financijskih usluga prodrla je u državu i počela prilagođavati zakone u svoju korist.
The degree of capture, political capture by the City of London, by the big banks and the big law firms is so enormous that the politicians have effectively become their spokespersons.
Budući da vlada nije spremna djelovati u interesu javnosti, skupina prosvjednika suočila se s Daveom Hartnettom na privatnoj proslavi u Oxfordu.
Hi everybody, I'm sorry to interrupt. It's just going to take a few moments of your time. Here tonight to present Dave with an award is the Lifetime Achievement Award for services to corporate tax planning.
Thank you very much.
Dave's been a great friend to the industry, a great friend to many of us over the years, and you know, really we just can't thank him enough for what he's done.
Obviously it was at Vodafone, you know, it saved us billions off our tax bill, and our friends at Goldman Sachs as well, we've also saved us millions.
25 million or so.
These people are trespassers and intruders.
And I know you've had problems with pesky professors.
This is an unlawful conspiracy to trespass. And you will go,
really,
sir.
Like
you will depart immediately before we set the dogs on you. Okay, go. You're trespassing.
Okay.
You are trespassing, scum. Go.
Nakon odlaska u mirovinu, Dave Hartnett prešao je u privatni sektor. radi u računovodstvenoj tvrtki Deloitte i savjetuje strane vlade o oporezivanju poduzeća. Dave Hartnett član je britanskog viteškog reda, što je čast koju dodjeljuje sam britanski monarh.
We have former ministers acting as advisors to accountancy firms. Accountancy firms provide jobs and consultancies for potential ministers. To my mind, really, it's an indication of corrupt structures. People are buying and selling influences. When a former minister works for an accountancy firm, he's not providing any accounting knowledge, he's opening political opportunities, home and abroad. That is what they are doing.
I hope by now you'll share my view that I don't trust most bankers, I don't trust most lawyers, I don't trust most accounting firms. I actually think they're engaged in a conspiracy against public interest.
Londonski City bio je financijsko središte Britanskog carstva. Kako je moć carstva opadala, City se preobrazio iz središta koje je upravljalo financijskom mašinerijom carstva u globalni financijski centar. Nekoć nevažna područja carstva postala su osnova za paukovu mrežu offshore jurisdikcija koja je hvatala bogatstvo iz cijelog svijeta i usmjerila ga u poslovno središte Londona. Danas je 25% međunarodnih financijskih transakcija obavlja na britanskom teritoriju. Gotovo je polovina svjetskih poreznih oaza pod britanskom zaštitom. Polovina offshore bogatstva možda se skriva u britanskim poreznim utočištima. Britanske elite zarađuju pružajući financijske usluge, a u poreznim oazama bivši vladini ministri, visoko pozicionirani državni službenici i umirovljeni obavještajci iz službi MI5 i MI6 dobivaju unosne savjetničke položaje nakon rada u državnoj službi. Zajedno su preobrazili Britaniju i njezine prekomorske teritorije u najveću svjetsku poreznu oazu, koja šteti razvoju zemalja diljem svijeta i pretvara samu Britaniju u zemlju koja poneprije postupa u interesu svojih elita. Thank you.